Hello all, good morning. So we have Ms. Mayuri with us, and she has done engineering and later switched to physics, and which kind of is where our community Citizens of Science started, physics after engineering. And I thought, why not invite her to share her story, and because all the members that are in our community, they are currently either in masters or doing their PhDs, and we don't really have a perspective of someone who has been through all of that and gone to the other side of it. So just wanted to interact with someone who can tell us the perspective after all of this is done. So let's just dive into that. And before that, like Mayuri is currently working as a scientist in RRI Bengaluru. And she works on astronomy. What in particular, I don't know. Maybe Mayuri can just elaborate a bit.
I'll give a detailed introduction, don't worry.
Yeah, please.
I'll start. So Dr. Mayuri S. Rao, she is a research associate at the Raman Research Institute and an affiliate with the physics division at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory. She has a background in electronics and communication engineering and graduated with a PhD in from the Research School of Astronomy and Astrophysics of the Australian National University. So Dr. Rao primarily works in experimental cosmology, experimental detection of weak spectral distortions in the cosmic microwave background arising from the epoch of recombination, foreground modeling for the epoch of recombination and the epoch of reionization. She is also interested in various aspects of instrumentation in radio astronomy, including antenna design and developing calibration techniques to minimize and characterize systematics. Her other interests include developing educational resources for school children, reading and traveling. Her website also has a lot of great resources and notes from cosmology. So we'll share the link and you can check that out later on. We'll start with the interview now.
Okay, so you develop content for children as well, yeah?
Yes, I do, yeah. But anyway, before that, thanks a lot to Dishan, Taishi, and the whole team for this interaction. I'm looking forward to it, yeah.
Okay. So we also have guest here, Anshuman, unexpected guest. Yeah. Hi, Anshuman. Anshuman is currently doing his master's. What is it? Sorry.
PhD. Yeah.
Yeah. Doing his PhD in Max Planck.
And his Max Planck Institute for Astrophysics.
Welcome, Anshuman.
Yeah,
I actually work as a school teacher. Mayuri, working for some opportunities. Like I work as a school teacher, math actually, but I interact with other teachers as well. Have something, please share it with us.
I think your voice is breaking for me just a bit, Dishan.
It's better now?
Slightly, yeah.
That's fine, you can carry on, yeah.
Divyanshu was starting, so.
Yeah. So I will ask the first question. How did you become interested in science? Was there a particular instance or experience that you would like to share regarding this?
Sure. Thanks, Divyanshu. So I got into science as a profession somewhat accidentally, but I think from my schooling onwards, I was very interested in physics. And then where I had, as most of us do, these kind of choices of medicine or engineering, and sciences are not something that we think about actively unless there is a strong motivation to. So I think my curiosity in physics led me to take up a degree in engineering, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. And after I completed my engineering, when I was looking for various opportunities, I came across an opportunity for a job at Raman Research Institute. And I applied for this job, I was interviewed, and I got selected. And then gradually my association with the group at Raman Research Institute kind of paved my path as towards a career in science. So it was kind of accidental as a choice of career after my engineering.
So before you joined Raman Research Institute, did you have any prior exposure to astrophysics?
Not particularly, if I'm being very honest. I think I had a curiosity about things, and I had a phase, I'm sure, during my school days when I wanted to be an astronomer. But I think it was more about seeing the way that engineering applies to astronomy, once I joined Raman Research Institute, that I kind of got fascinated with it a lot more. And that's kind of when I kind of decided to pursue my PhD in astronomy.
Okay. So how did your engineering degree help you in astronomy? Because when we talk to people who want to get into astro, they're usually confused that, you know, BSc is a better option. It will help you, you know, better in your journey rather than engineering, because, you know, there are other eligibility requirements, so on and so forth. So, you know, how did your undergrad degree help you with that?
Right.
Were there any limitations to that?
No, it helped me quite a lot, actually. And like I mentioned, my path to get into astronomy and my PhD is not very traditional. But at the same time, a lot of my peers and colleagues also have a similar background. Because I think when most people think of astronomy, they have a very specific idea of what astronomy involves or what a PhD or a job in astronomy involves. But to enable astronomy and to make astronomy happen, you need a much more diverse set of skills. In addition to somebody thinking about the data and the data processing, you need to have people who are building the telescopes, who understand the telescopes and how these telescopes will do the science. And even in engineering, there are various types of engineering degrees. So right from, say, mechanical engineering to electronics or to computer science, it all fits into the part of the way the astronomy is done today than somebody who has done physics, BSc, MSc, PhD, and they study one part of astronomy, but that's just a part of everything that it involves. So I think a lot of the things that I studied in engineering, and genuinely I might have not thought they might have application, are my bread and butter today. The kinds of plots we use, the kinds of tools and equipment that we studied are things that I use routinely in my lab. So it is probably much more related to astronomy and the way I'm doing astronomy as part of our group than maybe if I'd taken up a job in a different stream following engineering.
So, what do you think of the current trend of people joining engineering? I mean, most of them are just interested in the particular placement section of that.
Right.
So, but yeah, it does help to gather some skills. And if we are talking about science and applied science fields, what do you think about that?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think it is a fact that people do study engineering because that's where a lot of the jobs are. But at the same time, I think if people know what opportunities are out there for them to put their engineering skills to use, for example, a lot of the jobs, as we know, especially in India and perhaps more so in Bangalore, a lot of the jobs are in software. So even if you might be studying things like electrical, mechanical, your expectation of what might come out of 4 years of your degree is to join a software company and you write code. Which may be the truth. So there is a certain element of truth to it. And, you know, it is a reality that, you know, ultimately you've got to pay your bills. And that's important that you have jobs in that profession. But at the same time, I think if people do know that there are opportunities to apply your engineering skills in sciences and potentially, you know, kind of continue in that as a profession, it might encourage more people to search widely. It's as a trend, there's no such thing as a good or bad thing, but it will be nice if more students are aware of opportunities. It could be in physics, it could be in various other fields, but for sure, I think most such basic sciences or science-related opportunities don't necessarily come to campus for placement or recruitment. So that's kind of, there's natural reason to go for engineering.
Yeah.
The reason I started this is that because of that, like this complete lack of awareness about opportunities after 12th. The dream of I want to be next Sachin, I want to be Kohli, whatever, I want to be a dancer, artist, astronaut, they come very early age. So you look around, you see, okay, I'll become that, you take your ideals, and then after 10th, you have to make a choice. You have to choose either math or biology. The people who usually hate math, they take biology, which is a very wrong thing to do. Like, you should consider all the options. And then it starts from right there. going with the herd and keeps going on. And after 12, you really want to be something else. Your dreams are elsewhere, but you don't have any clue how to get there. So just look around, okay, everyone's going, why not I do too? And then, yeah, that's precisely how a lot of people in the community that we have, they all are. Many of them are from mechanical. Like when I do surveys in our community, turns out that like 30-40% of the people in physics after engineering community come from mechanical background. The reason being, someone at some point told them that mechanical has a lot of physics in it. Partly true, but it's not the traditional physics that you study. So this lack of guidance kind of led people to like go elsewhere. We are trying to work on that. Even Anshuman is quite active on Quora. So I was hearing from someone a couple of days ago. So they got into some ISERs. So they were telling, some guy asked the girl, like, how did you prepare for ISERs? So they said, like, what resource do we have? I have nothing but Anshuman's answer. So that, popular, yes, like
that's great.
Loads of that's great. Yeah, yes, a lot of stuff doing, and quite appreciate him for that, because the time, I guess it's very late in the night there, Anshuman. 1 o'clock in the night.
No, right now it's 1:30, like it's lunchtime here. So I just had my lunch early.
Yeah. That's good. Thanks for joining in, man. Yeah, appreciate it. So even the website, the same business of science, like I want to expand it to all fields. I want to go for physics, biology, whatever, even architecture, design, whatever, because people at any age, they should know everything, like what all options they have, what they like, then maybe they can choose. But like just everybody going to that field, we're losing a lot of productivity in that sense, because it's people doing about, things just for the sake of it. Sorry.
It's also about, you know, getting aware at the right age. I mean, there are things which I wish I would have known, you know, when I was in 12. And, you know, some years earlier, but, you know, and then ultimately people end up taking gaps and end up taking, it did do a stop.
And even Mayuri, I think luck has played a very nice factor in your thing, right? Like if you had not known about the opportunity of RRI internship, I mean, whatever you do, done. You might have been coding as well.
Yeah, no, I mean, so it is true that, you know, see, the thing is, there are opportunities, but at some point, it also involves some risk. You are going against the crowd, and you have to be able to give up a safety net that, you know, which many people or your peers might have. So it's not an easy decision to take also for most people.
So even we do come across a lot of such people. Even people who join MSc after engineering, they're still like, she is the right decision. There's a lot of internal struggle. So what did I like quit a job? Because India is still a developing country, not in the luxury to follow.
Exactly. It's good to have a safety net where you know you can go and attend placements, and you know, and that is a critical factor in, you know, choosing a career.
I think this is where the engineering versus the BSc thing weighs in at the end, having a safety net.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
Sort of. Yeah. And Anshuman, what do you think is the case? I mean, like, let's talk about ISERS as such, because they're the top places for science as such.
For people who are applying to ISERS, like the main question is that even if they get the seat, it is like, should I join? Like every single person that they know and they look up to, like the teachers, relatives, parents, everyone says, no, screw it, go for engineering whatever, or medicine, whatever is their leaning. And sometimes even they feel like that because that's what they have been told all the time. So the issue that comes is that a lot of times people are just not aware. Another issue is that it's not like you, just because you did a bachelor, like, for example, we can flip it for Mayuri's case, and for our case, it is like just because someone did a bachelor's in physics or say in biology or whatever, it does not mean that they are going to continue in research. So that is also something a lot of people don't know, even though there are like already a lot of people out there who are doing a lot of different things, because the undergrad is just where you are learning a certain bunch of skills, and then how you exactly apply, where you apply it is you build upon that based on how your interests change. And that is something that is really not conveyed to students at the during the high school level, because for whatever reason, like it just is like everything is given to them in the sense that you just do this much and then it will be set, like life set in. So that creates a wrong impression, because it is even something like everything becomes very tied to like just because like if you do this, then you have no other option but to continue in that path. So that is something that is like a good effective counter to that is basically bringing out examples of people and also like making students aware in general. So it's good that we are talking to Mayuri, because that's basically the other side of the coin, like having done engineering but then going into sciences is also doable.
Okay, so moving on, you took a gap of 4 years between, you know, after finishing your undergrad and then moving on to PhD. So was that gap, did it cause any problems, like, you know, getting back into academics, going back to college? Were there any issues that you faced in particular?
Right. So the gap in my case was not too problematic, because I was working in the field that I was eventually going to do a PhD in, so it was helpful. And for most people, when they do apply for a PhD, and not saying master's in this case, but especially a PhD when they apply, it helps to have an understanding of the kind of environment or what research involves, because it is a different type of education than most undergraduate degrees, especially in India, where it's more textbooks, exams, classes. But a PhD program is much more hands-on, independent. So my 4 years gap was while I was working at RRI doing astronomy and some engineering. So it was helpful in my case. But certainly there is always this kind of momentum that you need to pick up once again in terms of, because a PhD program, most PhD programs have the first year of what is called as coursework, where you do have assignments, you might have some classes you need to attend. So get back into that framework of learning in a certain structured way. So that it takes a bit of reinitiating that momentum. But I think for the most part, depends upon when you take the gap, what you're doing in that gap, and that's what matters at the end. So if the gap is in line with what you eventually will start doing, then it's not as disruptive. I mean, not to say that it's always disruptive either. Some people are able to make that jump quickly, but I don't think it necessarily very adversely impacts your applications if you're going for a PhD type of a degree. For a master's, it may be a little different. But for a grad school or a PhD, et cetera, it doesn't matter too much.
Because I remember, I think a couple of weeks ago, there was a discussion going on the Citizens of Science group that should they take a gap, you know, to either earn and, you know, settle up and then go for a PhD. Because oftentimes what happens is that by the time they finish their PhDs, sometimes they may not be eligible for some of the university's requirements if they want to get into academia. So I remember they were talking, should we take a gap? Should we not take a gap?
Yeah, no. So I think just to kind of put it out there, many jobs in India in academia, especially university jobs where you would apply if you want to stay in academia, because it's not necessary, by the way, if you do a PhD, you have to go into academia also. You can go into industry. That's always an option. But let's say you want to be in academia or apply to universities to be an assistant professor. Typically, there is an age cutoff of there's an age thing of about 35 years. And there are exceptions to this, but that it is a reality. But I think, it's very much on a case-to-case basis. You know, it depends upon your family situation, your personal financial situation, you know, to take this choice of gap year or not. But if people are intending to take a gap year to prepare for exams or something like that, it's highly encouraged to do a research internship so that that also strengthens your CV and your statement of purpose when you apply. Because in addition to your exams, that will add a lot of value to, you know, your break.
Especially if one is applying abroad, where they look at the overall profile of the students, like especially if we take the Indian case, then there's usually an entrance exam and then an interview where
interview.
Not much attention is given to, you know, the background or the research projects that one has done previously. But if we're planning to go abroad, then the profile building is really necessary.
Right. But I am seeing that in some cases, even in Indian institutions, of course, you have to clear the entrance exams. But if you have done some research work that is already aligned with the group that you're applying to work with as a PhD student, they ask you more questions about that and they try to see if you're a good fit, and it does help. But of course, you have to clear the initial entrance. Yeah.
Okay. So are the permanent academic positions very hard to get in India or outside India also?
Yeah. Yeah, they are hard to get. Yes, not just in India, it's hard everywhere. So you will see that, you know, typically after PhDs, the natural course, if you want to stay in academia, is to do what you call as a postdoc. It's called postdoctoral fellowship or something. So it depends on the field completely. People might do 1, 2, 3 postdoctoral fellowship, each lasting between 1, 2, 3 years. So people are like a postdoc for a long time. And then when you start applying, that's when you see the maximum number of people drop off the academia radar and they switch to industry when they're trying to make that transition. So honest answer, yes, it is hard. Yeah. I don't have like numbers or statistics in my hand about this, but it is hard. Yeah.
So is it very hard also to get the PDF in that particular area of research that you were doing, that postdoctoral position in that area only? Because can you search the areas to different areas also after the PhD?
Yeah. So postdocs are relatively easier. I'm not saying it's easy. It's always competitive. So once you finish your PhD, everybody who is finishing a PhD around the same time as you will be applying for postdocs, most likely to similar places. But it still is better than the job, the transition to applying to faculty positions. And in terms of the field, it completely depends. Again, for example, I did my PhD in a certain research topic, and I did my postdoc in a slightly different area. In fact, it sometimes is encouraged to expand your research horizons and your skill set during your postdoc days and not continue exactly the same thing you're doing your PhD. But then again, it depends very much field to field. For me, it helped me because I learned a new set of skills and I was able to bring what I had learned in my PhD to the table. So in that sense, the pool is still slightly bigger and postdocs are slightly better than, the job search later.
So you've been affiliated to institutes both in India and abroad. So how would you say the amount, how would you compare the amount of independence that you get while doing your research work?
Right. So in India, I've mostly been at Raman Research Institute. And so I had a singular experience and it's been really nice. So I don't have any personal experience about other institutes in India. And so in that sense, RRI has been a really nice place to work and similar level of research independence as abroad. One of the things that does make a big difference between the working style in India and abroad is the amount of funding that is available. And that makes quite a bit of the difference, especially in an experimental field where you need to be buying equipment or using lab space and, you know, maybe getting, having a bigger group because, you know, the PI of the group can afford it. So in that sense, the environment is more, enables quicker turnaround, more cutting edge technology outside than in India. Hopefully it is beginning to change as, you know, more and more grants are coming up and PIs are writing more grants. But I think that is the biggest difference in the research style. But in terms of research independence, I found it equally good, but maybe that's just been my experience. Mm-hmm.
Anshuman, do you have anything to add to this? I mean, I know it's been very recent that you moved to Germany, but...
Yeah, the thing is, even in India, I was affiliated, I just worked at ISIS. So at ISIS Mohali, obviously it's our own institute. So we had a kind of freedom in that sense because they saw us as their own students. So they were very happy and chill with it. They allowed me to go for the master's degree I did it elsewhere and even then they were okay with just grading it instead of like doing it in-house and everything. So that was quite nice. But then again, that does not give me a good perspective of everything. And there are, I am aware that there are cases where it is that people can be more controlling. But yeah, like it's not an India thing then, because it happens everywhere. There are weird people everywhere. So the experiences can vary. But yeah, it's been good so far. So like, let's see how it turns out ahead.
Okay. So we talked about the opportunities, other opportunities that people usually pursue apart from the postdoctoral fellows and everything. So what are these opportunities? I mean, what are these positions and industries? Where can we apply the things that we have done and learned in our during our PhD, such as in astronomy? So what are the places?
Right. So again, I think I lost you. Can you repeat the last part of that question? So,
just so what are the places that we can, I mean, apply to after getting a PhD in astronomy?
Okay, in industry. So specifically in astronomy, there are some things I can think of. Most people who say finish either the PhD or sometimes even after postdoc, if they have been doing astronomy with a lot of data, so data analysis, modeling, etc., many of them go into data science. Are you able to hear me? I think I'm having some internet.
Yeah, radio is live, but we can hear you.
Okay, let me know if I drop off. But anyway, so most people do go into data science, and there are a lot of companies looking for good data scientists who have good quantitative skills and critical thinking. So yeah, so data science, quantitative modeling, finance, because that also again employs a lot of big data. So those are some fields outside of academia. Then you can also consider industries such as if you have done things that involve some instrumentation, because even though it is science, you might still be using a lot of equipment and instrumentation. There could be companies that build these instruments or that do R&D in developing such scientific instruments. So that is another area. And some other fields would include things like, you can go into perhaps something more along the lines of consulting, where you are a subject matter expert in some type of physics. If not specifically in astronomy, it would be slightly tricky to find a consulting direct application. But if you have a good foundation in physics, you know, you could have a company that makes something that needs a good understanding of physics. So there are a range of opportunities out there which you may not directly associate with physics. But a lot of it is actually about the skills you have learned during PhD. So critical thinking, right? Again, programming, data analysis, all of this are basically job opportunities. You have to look along those lines.
So this data
science teacher like me. Yes. There are a few school teachers in my school. They have PhD. So,
yeah. And, oh yeah, absolutely.
Did any of your colleagues who did PhD along with you, like, did they end up in anything other than academia?
Hi, sorry, I completely lost.
That question was like, did you have any colleagues in your PhDs? In your PhD who are currently not in academia, and what are they doing now?
Oh yeah, quite a few people actually. If my network goes off again, I'll just try to join from my hotspot.
Yeah, it's fine, yeah. I guess you can.
We okay. Can still hear.
Plenty of people both from my PhD, some batchmates, as well as people who were postdocs when I was a PhD student, so who were slightly further up in the career track ahead of me. I know quite a few of them, and many of them, interestingly, like I mentioned, are in the banking sector. They've joined Ernst & Young, they've joined some consulting companies like KPMG and Deloitte. So yes, it there are quite a few of these examples.
Okay, so you did your PhD in which institute?
In Australian National University.
Okay. So they settled in companies working in Australia itself, or?
Not particularly. I think people have gone all over because invariably when you start applying also for postdocs, you apply more widely to various different countries. So typically people also might settle in the countries where they go for their postdocs, or like, you know, most cases they just go where the job takes them and where they have a work permit visa. So people have moved all over after their PhDs.
Okay, yeah. So as a scientist, you may have guided a few students to their PhDs, did you?
Mm-hmm.
Did any of them end up being a non-academic?
I have not yet, because I am not a faculty myself. I am a scientist, which means I have not yet fully advised PhD students myself. I have co-advised with other faculty members. For example, one of the PhD students I was working with when I was a postdoc in the US is working in industry right now in the US. He's an American citizen and he's working in industry right now.
So what are the major reasons that, you know, people leave astrophysics and then move on to industries?
I mean, honestly, it could be various reasons. It'll be definitely person specific. I can think of a few examples. One is right away after your, when you do your PhD, you may realize that you're not interested in academia. And that's a very kind of a common experience, because it may be that, you know, what lies ahead. You might see how competitive it is to get jobs. It might be partly the pay. It might be partly that you don't want to be in a field where you're advising students, etc., but you want to be doing your thing in a lab, or you know, you might be working somewhere in an industry where things are turning around at a much faster time scale. So that could be one of the reasons. And partly it could be for reasons of, you know, financial reasons, or it could be from after your postdoc years, you're trying for a long time and you have not been able to land a you know, faculty job. Mm-hmm. So it could be many reasons. Yeah.
So basically, research is a very demanding field right now, right? It takes a lot of time for us to settle down in the routine and to make sure that we are on the track for our PhDs or for our postdocs. So how do people cope with that? I mean, the pressure from the family in India is basically to earn so that they can have a better life and so that we can have a better life. And the other family pressures, the every kind of pressure that the society puts on us since we have started taking the engineering path. Yeah. So how does one deal with that? As the age passes by, it gets grow and grow. So how to deal with that? How do people deal with that in India?
Yeah. No, that's really hard, because I think especially here, you know, we do face a lot more pressure in our choice of career than maybe many other cultures. But I think on a personal level, I think it really helps to have a good support system, you know, to be able to have people who you can share your pressure with within your community, so who understand how hard it is, you know, to the pressure to publish, or, you know, some, you know, getting along with your guide or not getting results in the lab. So having somebody in the network that understands your nature of work helps. At the same time, I think it really helps to also have people who are completely outside in a different field, because it kind of helps keep it real and, you know, keeps you a little bit more humble, because you're struggling day in and day out with this one thing. But there are people out there who are doing very different things with different kind of pressure, and that really helps you kind of keep your head on your shoulder, because it's very easy to get cut off and be in a bubble where you don't realize that there's a lot more out there, and this is not like the worst thing ever. So that really helps. Yeah, and to be honest, I've seen the entire spectrum. I've seen families also being extremely supportive and helpful and understanding of, you know, how long it takes. At the same time, I have seen some students who I know who have quit because of, you know, some compulsion or pressure, but who have gone on to do other things that they are interested in and enjoy, and, you know, things, because it is, you know, you can't just keep these things compartment separate all the time, family and work. Sometimes it does get kind of mixed up. So I've seen people with all these kinds of things, but it really helps to have a good support system and have your own things and hobbies that you like pursuing that you can go to relax. All of these help. Yeah, maybe Anshuman can share what he has been doing for his relaxation in Germany.
It's been like just a month since I've come to Germany for like for the PhD. So it has been quite a lot of running around, in the sense that we have paperwork involved and everything. To relax, I guess, yeah. Like, it's just, as of now, it's just been maybe just learning how to cook, because that's, I've been trying cooking like dishes which I really miss from home, so that at least I have something nice to have, as well as it's, I have that time just where I can just listen to music, and just 1 or 2 hours I'm just with myself, which is nice. Other, and like even talking to, like I regularly talk with my relatives, parents, a few relatives, not all obviously, and parents with whom I can basically discuss about these things. Maybe even some friends who are, like a lot of people from ISIS go to different places. Like we have a lot of people who are around in Germany as well, so we are just talking and discussing so that we can share, like, yeah, this is bad, but okay, this is a lot of work, but yeah, we all are dealing with it. So yeah, that has been helpful so far. I would be probably like having something more formalized, like a more formal way of having some free time, in the sense that I would have a dedicated free time, so that I basically don't end up shifting my schedule according to work and then ending up burning myself out at some point in the PhD, but yeah, that will take time, but it is necessary, and that's, I would intend to have something like that, because otherwise if we are just working, we never know when we break down suddenly, because that can happen, and I have seen it happen. So
also the uncertainty with everything, it takes a toll on us, right? I mean, we don't know if we get the positions or not. We don't know if the funding is approved. We don't know if the thesis will go right or wrong. So yeah, there should be some venting place there so that the people can come and discuss the problems. Yeah. So these kind of systems are there in the universities when people do research and by doing PhD or something? Do people discuss these kinds of things, such as, I mean, if they are facing problems, so do they share this with their advisor and the other people in the PhD, that they are facing such kind of problems, they are not certain about various things?
It depends. Actually, I think more and more universities do have a more formal system of having a counselor or a mentor lately. There is more awareness both abroad and now also in India about mental health and burnout. But I think being able to approach that formal structure is not, maybe not everybody thinks of that as the first step, but it is available. At the same time, that's where it really helps to kind of have your own social circle and kind of not, you know, be in a hole and saying, oh, nobody will understand. It does help to take that time and take that break, even if you don't feel like it, and go out and meet your friends, you know, for a few hours a week. That really helps. But of course, this is not to say that everything is a light issue. There are some potentially serious mental health issues that people are now more aware about. And yeah, definitely more and more universities have a psychologist, counselor, mentor who you can go talk to. So yeah, it does exist. Yeah, it's good if more people kind of take advantage of these facilities when they need to.
So I know you've addressed this thing in one of your blogs as well, but how has your journey as a woman in science been? I know you've had a blog about all the traditional expectations that the society lays upon women. So how has your journey been?
Right. Yeah. So for me, it's been smoother in some ways than hope many people, and I'm fortunate because I've had good support from my family, but I know that's not always the case. But at the same time, I know that there are a lot of underlying systematic biases, and that is the hardest thing to kind of point out, because it's not like somebody comes up to you in a workplace and says something that's outright offensive. It's just that, maybe it's like body language, or maybe it's not being, if you're in a room full of people and many of them are men, you're not addressed directly, even though you may be somebody who should be asked that question. All of these things definitely do happen. And it's not just, I think, in sciences, it is being a woman in a workplace, also perhaps in India. There are, of course, the general things of, you have other responsibilities, especially when you live in a certain family setting in India versus, let's say, you're abroad, or you are in India in a different, away from home. So there are always going to be these kind of conflicting expectations of you from the workplace, from your colleagues, from home, from yourself. You just have to take it one thing at a time. You got to call things out when you see something outright wrong happening. Mm-hmm. You got to show your support to your colleagues, male or female, when it's like kind of not speaking up for them. You got to be that voice who speaks up. These things will take time to change, and it's not like one person is going to come around and change anything. But I know there are, especially in India, there is something called as the Astronomical Society of India. They have a women's chapter. They do a lot of programs and that encourage addressing women's issues. So this is something that is churning slowly, but it'll take time for it to become a topic that we don't discuss anymore.
Is it academia specific thing that you told?
Not necessarily,
initiative. You told that there's.
This is Astronomical Society of India. So this is a kind of part of many astronomers all over India who are part of this group. So many of their programs and activities are for women astronomers or aspiring women astronomers. But at the same time, there are many such organizations for women in general in science. So I'm sure there are plenty of organizations out there, but this is one I could think of in this field.
Because ultimately what happens is that when we see a lot of women get into STEM in the educational way, but when it comes to, translating that numbers into workforce, it drastically goes down, maybe because of the infrastructure, or as you said, a lot of family constraints.
Absolutely. I think this is one thing that has been noticed widely in academia, and I'm sure there is a certain equivalent in corporate or in industry as well. But in academia, it's typically when you are at your postdoc age is also when you might want to start having kids, and that's when also most women start dropping out of the workforce, or particularly academia. So that phase when you're in your postdoc or transitioning from postdoc to applying to become a faculty member is your peak work stress phase, or you need to be most productive then, but at the same time you're probably in your early to mid or maybe late 30s, and you got to start thinking about other things as well. So in academia, this is a very significant problem that many people recognize. Hopefully, there are some institutional things in place. Especially in India, you do have government allowed 6 months for maternity. So, but these are women specific issues in academia, but at the same time, it could very well translate to, taking on a bigger role in industry.
Ayushi, do you have any more questions? Yes, we've gone through the most of the questions. that we had.
I think the most are she there.
Yeah, I think her video is frozen.
Yeah, okay. Divyanshu, you have any questions left over on the list?
Yeah, we have almost gone through most of the questions. Yeah.
Can I add something here? I think in general, yeah. So I know a lot of this thing that we've been talking about is about, you know, transitioning from, say, engineering to science, or maybe even converse. But one thing that I would like to add specifically for people who are trying to look to make this transition from engineering to science after their BE is, of course, yeah, go for it. You should, you know, it's possible. There are a lot of opportunities out there. But remember that you having come from an engineering background is also a strength. So you don't have to kind of feel like out of place or feel, you know, bad that you don't have a physics background when all of your peers have a physics background when you do PhD in physics. So what you have studied in engineering is an asset. So keep that as an asset. And that's an extra skill that you bring to the table. That is a strength. So it's you have to kind of make sure that you keep that skill set alive. And there are a lot of things you can do in physics or basically in sciences, in addition to having that engineering background. So that's not a bad thing, is what I'm saying. In fact, it's a great thing. It is an advantage that you have over most people maybe in that field. So yeah, you got to remember that, and that helps.
Right. Thank you very much for adding that.
Yeah, yeah.
Aishi, yeah. You have any other questions, Aishi? The list. Unmute yourself. Yeah.
I think most of them have been answered during the discussion that we've had.
That's great. That's great. And so, by the way, the project you've done, how long have you done that, Mayuri, and was that funded while you were doing it?
Which project? Is this my PhD or?
After your engineering, you've done work with RRI, right?
Right. Oh, so I've done many, if you call it project, I've done many such projects, because when I joined RRI, I joined as an employee, as a full-time employee. I was not a project student or something like that. It was an advertised job for, in this institute that I address. So as in my role as an employee, I've done quite a few projects. For my PhD thesis problem itself, I worked on it for about a few years, and the funding for this came from the institute, but the trend is changing. So the project, one of the projects that I am leading right now is something that we wrote a grant for and, you know, has been funded by an external government agency. So there are various modes of funding. It depends on which project and which institute, etc.
Okay. That's great.
Yeah.
And so what do you think of the scenario for entering in projects or internships for people in engineering? There are a lot of people in our community who want like to switch to like astro, and they may want to like get a taste of research first. So if they like projects, internships, what would you suggest for them to have there in their profile so that they'll be picked among a bunch of people that apply?
Right. No, absolutely. I think it's essential and I would highly encourage it. So different institutes in India, especially in astronomy, have different programs. Depends upon the length and duration of the project you'd like to do. But for example, Raman Research Institute has something called as the Visiting Student Program, or VSP, where the students work with faculty members for nominal stipend for a certain duration of time. So there is more information available on the RRI website for this. Another common way is to write to faculty members who you're interested in working with, email them. But I highly encourage you to reword your email well, be polite, because there are some emails that just say, "Hi, I want to work with you, full stop." And I get many people send such emails. And if you're conscious about the language or your English, you're not comfortable, get somebody to help you. That's perfectly fine. Please always remember to attach your CV, because just saying, "Do you have an internship available?" will not make the cut, because as much as faculty or professors might want to help you, when they don't have all the information there, they're not going to put in that extra effort all the time to reach out to you and ask you, "Can you share your CV? What do you want to work on?" So write nice emails. And please take help from people if you are conscious about your language skills. Attach your CV and make sure you put in the effort to read the work that the person is working on. Don't send blank emails. Don't send emails addressed to the wrong person to the wrong person. If you think you know you're writing to a lady, don't say, "Dear sir." You know, this happens all the time. So make sure the person on the other end of the email knows you have actually put in that effort and you are genuinely interested. So, because if you send like a forward email to everybody, it's very obvious and many people may not respond. So these are some basic tips, which you would think people know, but you would be surprised by the number of bad emails that come.
Something about having in the profile, like you mentioned about CV. So what would you be looking in a CV?
Right. So yes, which is where it helps a lot to look through the profile of the person who you're writing to. For example, a few things that are nice, irrespective of the exact research problem that you might want to work on or the group's interests, are mention your programming skills. If you know Python, if you know MATLAB, or if you know C programming, or you know some other simulation package that you've used. If you're a mechanical engineer and you've used SolidWorks or AutoCAD, so put your, skills. Your skills are important. Of course, your grades and your marks are important, and that will be on your CV. But any programming skills, please mention it. If you have already worked with some other, groups or your projects, mention that. That's very important. And be prepared to answer questions relating to your own project. If you don't answer your own project related questions well, that's seen poorly in a kind of interview. Mention, for example, if you have taken any numerical courses, because most projects do involve some type of numerical techniques. So if you're taking numerical courses.
Certifications help, like say MIT, OCW?
Yeah, sometimes it helps, sometimes it doesn't. It completely depends on the person and the project that you're writing. Of course, if you've done it, it should be on your CV. But at the same time, don't assume that that always helps. I think it completely depends on the person and the type of project they might have in mind for you. Yeah, it helps to the extent that it shows that you have interest in this field beyond what you've done in your coursework. That's pretty much it. Yeah.
I think it ultimately all depends on whether one can answer questions that the professor has. Just writing off things doesn't help.
So one other thing I'd like to say here, and this is for this type of interview and also for your PhD admission interviews, is beyond your exam writing stage, you should remember that people who conduct interviews have probably been doing this for a long, long time. They don't necessarily ask you questions like, 2 + 2, what is it? It's not a question answer format. They want to test your ability to think critically, to analyze a problem, to see the steps that you kind of approach getting to the problem. That is valued a lot in a PhD interview or in an interview for an internship in a research group. Because they want to see, if I give you a problem, are you able to take it to the next 2-3 steps? And that is the skill they're looking for, as much as, do you remember this fact about this thing that you studied in a textbook? That is not what matters. So just like Ayushi said, when you don't have to prepare in the sense that I need to know every answer to every question possible, as much as, am I thinking critically? Am I answering logically? And they will give you questions. They'll help you get to the answer. You need to be able to take the clues and approach the interview in that format versus I need to mug up something from a book. That's not what it is about.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. They are very helpful in this. Like if you even if you forget stuff, like they'll try to help you with it, give you some hints that they will never give you the answer directly as such, but try to get you connect the dots and get
absolutely it. And you have to keep an open mind to be able to connect the dots, and that's what they're looking for.
What else, Anshuman? Any questions?
I think we're reaching the 1-hour limit that we set.
Yeah, sure.
Unless we have other questions.
Well passed. I mean, like, you have any conclusion that you can say, Mayuri? We'll just end.
I think I've said everything, but everyone has a kind of their own unique path. So I think people should keep that in mind. And there is no such thing as there is no going back from this decision. So if you've done engineering, you want to do science, you should go for it, but explore opportunities widely. And like I said, what you've already done is your asset. It's something unique you're bringing to the table. So you should own it, should be proud of it. So keep at it, and vice versa. If you're going from science to some other field, again, remember science is a background you have that's helpful. That's a good thing. And you guys are doing some really nice, interesting, good work. So I'm happy to kind of share my experience. And I hope you keep up the good job. I'll keep my eye out for what more comes from you guys. Yeah.
So does this mean I can recommend certain students to you?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I'm usually good at replying to emails from students. I may be late, but I do my best to reply to as many student mails as I can. We do have a screening process where we look through their CVs and talk to students and see if they're a good fit for the projects we might have in mind. But I'm happy to kind of, talk to them or reply to mails. I try my best to reply to as many mails as possible. I don't know if I can keep it up, but I do my best. Yeah, for sure.
That's great. That's great. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Mayuri. Yeah.
And Shuman, thank you all so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.